Lenin had been in exile for many years. He was in Switzerland when the Romanov dynasty was overthrown. But he was able to return to Russia, cross the war zones, in a SEAL train provided by the Germans. The Germans counted on him to take Russia out of the war, thus releasing all of their armies for new offensives on the Western fronts. When Lenin attained power, he acted as they expected, and the Allies almost lost the war. Leon Trotsky was another exile. He was a brilliant speaker and for years had studied military strategy. At the start of the revolution, he was in New York, working on the socialist newspaper. When he arrived in Petrograd in the spring of 1917, he became Lenin's right-hand man and eventually organized the triumphant Red Army. Joseph Jugashvili, known as Stalin, was another important Bolshevik. The revolution found him in exile in the Siberian Arctic. The provisional government having released all political prisoners, Stalin hastened to Petrograd, joined Lenin, and helped plot the overthrow of the Kerensky regime. The Kerensky government wanted to stay in the war. Had the Allies supported the provisional government with food and weapons, the Bolshevik seizure of power might have been prevented.
Well, how did the Bolsheviks gain popularity among the people, Mr. Lyon?
Well, when the revolution began, councils of workers, peasants, and soldiers, called Soviets, sprang up all over the country. And that's where the Bolsheviks, though a minority, rapidly expanded their popular appeal with slogans of peace, land, and bread, and all power to the Soviets. In November 1917, an all-Russian Congress of Soviets met in Petrograd. In its name, the Bolsheviks staged their long-planned coup d'etat. They seized all public buildings and facilities. The Kerensky government fled. Lenin was master of Petrograd. This was the second, or Bolshevik, revolution. It touched off a long and bloody civil war, with the Reds fighting Tsarist armies on the one hand, various democratic armies on the other. But in the end, the Red Army under Trotsky, backed by unlimited Red Terror, was in control of the country. It was Russia's tragic losses in World War I that put the communists in power. All subsequent world history has been colored by that one event, certainly the most important consequence of the war to end wars.
Next, America enters the war. The Germans said it would never happen, but American soldiers were on their way to Europe a few months after the United States declared war. The Navy safely convoyed the first troops, as they would almost 2 million more, across more than 3,000 miles of water, sweeping U-boats and mines out of the shipping lanes. It was late June when they arrived, the first American army ever to set foot on the continent. Most of them were only a few generations removed from Europe, but all of them, whatever their names or backgrounds, fought as Americans and answered to the name Yank. They paraded in London past cheering crowds, most of whom mourned the death of a soldier in France or Belgium. They marched past Buckingham Palace, past the Royal Family and Prime Minister Lloyd George. It was indeed a historical day. American soldiers come to fight alongside the English.
I saw them come into Paris on the 4th of July, the first time the French people had seen an American soldier, and they went wild with joy. They were eager, tough, confident, fresh young men, these Americans. They hadn't fired a shot, but they brought enormous hope to the war-weary people of Paris. I didn't see excitement like that until 27 years later, when Paris was liberated in World War II.
This is Burnett Hershey, who's been telling us about one of the most colorful events of the war. He was in Paris as a correspondent during both world wars and is a past president of the Overseas Press Club. Mr. Hershey, what was it like reporting the war news in those days?
Well, I can tell you it was a lot different from World War II, when 750 correspondents were given every chance to get stories. General Eisenhower was quite accessible to the press, but during World War I, when there were only 31 of us, it was almost impossible to reach Pershing.
You mean that Pershing didn't see the press?
Very seldom. You were handed a typewritten communique from time to time, and that was it. No direct contact with the general himself. For instance, one of the big problems was that General Foch, as Supreme Commander, wanted to use American troops in a piecemeal fashion, that is, integrating them with British and French brigades. Pershing didn't want this. Some of us got a tip that he and Foch were having a conference about it. There were correspondents like Heywood Broun, Damon Runyon, and myself waiting to find out what the result of the meeting would be. When it was over, the generals walked past us. No questions were allowed. We only learned that Pershing had won his point from his press officer.
But you were allowed to visit the front line.
On special occasions, yes, and always under the watchful eye of a conducting officer. But it took a long time between that great day in Paris and the first major American force in action. Pershing first had to build up his army in France. It was slow at first, but it began to snowball after a while. Men, ammunition, food, guns, trucks. And suddenly it was all there. An army ready to fight. It was early in the summer of 1918 that Americans went into a big battle for the first time. At the time, the Germans were a mere 49 miles from Paris, reinforced by divisions released by the collapse of Russia and commanded by the German Crown Prince, the son of the Kaiser. Between them and the capital were only exhausted French troops. And when they began to withdraw, the Germans were astonished to see that their replacements were not the usual dead-tired reserves, but doughboys, fresh, enthusiastic American soldiers. The 2nd American Division with a brigade of Marines that went into the historic Battle of Belleau Wood. Some of us, as correspondents, were privileged to see the action as it was taking place. Floyd Gibbons, one of the most famous correspondents, was wounded and lost an eye. We were that close. The battlefield swarmed with German machine gun nests, and our casualties were dreadful. But the American Marines kept moving in day after day for almost 3 weeks. In the end, our soldiers won. They had proven themselves as fighters. They had given our battle-scarred allies, the French and the British, a great boost in morale.
America was now a full partner in the war effort. Doughboys fought alongside the French poilu and the British Tommies. General Foch launched a giant offensive to end the war, and the Allies pushed on. They wrote history at Chateau Thierry, pushed the Germans back at Soissons, made advances at the Somme River and in Flanders. They smashed into the Argonne Forest, and the whole structure of Germany and its allies began to crumble. King Ferdinand of Bulgaria quit in September. The Italians hit the Austrians at the Piave River. 300,000 surrendered. The last Austrian emperor, Karl, asked for an armistice. The British General Allenby captured Jerusalem and swept on to smash the Turkish army in Palestine. The Turks were in a panic, and the Sultan asked for an armistice. In France and Belgium, the fighting continued. And while the German army kept falling back, the Kaiser was making peace overtures to President Wilson. The socialists refused to cooperate with the government in Berlin. Then suddenly, it stopped. It was 11 o'clock on the morning of November 11th, 1918. This was the armistice. Man was the brother of man. In Paris, in London, in New York, in Berlin, in many cities and in many hearts, peace had come. The tyrants had been banished. The enemies had gone. 9 million had died. And the war to end wars was ended.
There was one more act to the drama. The great powers met at Versailles, just outside Paris, to make a treaty of peace. The important questions were settled by the Big Four: President Wilson of the United States, Lloyd George, Prime Minister of Great Britain, Premier Clemenceau of France, and Premier Orlando of Italy. They created the League of Nations to settle differences among nations, made it impossible for Germany to fight another war, demanded that Germany accept full responsibility for the war and make reparations in cash and goods for the damage she had caused. The peace then became official. And lest any man forget the horrors of the four long years, the 9 million dead, the 21 million wounded, and the wanton destruction, they buried an unknown soldier at Arlington, Virginia, a bitter reminder to men to maintain the peace.